5 minutes from the top. Just lift up your hands with me for just a moment. Oh, God, your presence is so beautiful. It's so strong in this place here today. Lord, without you, we can't do anything at all. We humble ourselves before you in your mighty presence. For Lord, there's a holiness in this place today. There's a holiness, there's a help from the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There's a word for somebody in this place here this afternoon. God, sometimes we're looking for a miraculous thing to just happen in the snap of a finger, but sometimes transformation takes a little while. So God, I'm not concerned even about just the ordinary response that may happen in one service. But Lord, as a pastor, I'm looking for life change. I'm looking to plant a seed today to give somebody hope and to give somebody help and a word from God. That'll help them to do something for you. That'll help them get back on track. That'll help them be what you called them to be. Oh, Jesus, I welcome you here today. God, we're just all clay. We're just all clay in the hands of the Lord. Oh, come and mold us. Somebody pray that for a minute. Jesus, just come and mold my life. Oh, come and mold me. Come and make me. Come and shape me like what you want me to be. Oh, you're the pot. I'm just the clay. Hallelujah. I'm in the Father's name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. You can be seated and just let's just keep a spirit of worship here. Today there's just such a precious presence of the Lord that's deep and it's powerful here this afternoon. I want the Lord to talk to you tonight through His Word and through His Spirit. I know sometimes when we think about preaching that perhaps we have a certain mindset. Maybe that certain mindset is that it has to be this loud, demonstrative, almost rip-roaring yell for it to be preaching. But you know, it doesn't have to be that way. Preaching is the Word of the Lord given to people. What I'm looking for tonight is for you to just whatever the Lord does this afternoon, however He comes across in this message, however it's presented, I want you to know that He has your best interest in mind. Amen. The Lord has your best interest in mind. Amen. I read a story some time ago about some friends that decided to climb Mount Everest together. Mount Everest, as you may know, is the highest place on earth. Some 29,035 feet above sea level. Due to the treacherous conditions that they sometimes face, it can take up to several weeks even to make the climb all the way to the top. These men have been climbing for many days already. If you know anything about that kind of climbing, you have to go a certain level and then make camp. Then you go up another level and you make camp and your body has to continually adjust to the air and to the conditions around you. But there was something very interesting that these guys had climbed for days. Obviously, they were all very weary and very tired. The weather was cold and the climbing was getting increasingly difficult the higher that they went. One day after climbing for several hours, one of the men turned to his friends and he said, "Guys, I'm sorry, but I just can't handle anymore. My body is shot. I'm weary. I'm tired. I can't go any farther." So he turned around and he went back down to the camp. The rest of the guys realized this is a once-in-a-lifetime chance and opportunity for us. We're sorry that our friend decided to go back down, but we didn't come here to turn around. We came to go all the way to the top. And this is something that's very interesting about this story because the rest of the team kept going. And 5 minutes later, they reached the top. Their friend that turned around, folks, listen very carefully. He turned around and quit with only 5 more minutes to go. He was 5 minutes from the top. See, this is one of the biggest problems with quitting. You see, you don't always understand how close that you really are to the very end.
Right.
You don't really know how close you are to finally having victory in your life. You don't really know how close you are to overcoming, because at that one particular moment, instead of going on, you decided to turn around and go back down in a different direction. Now, you can call Naaman a lot of things in our text, but one thing that you can't call this guy is a quitter. I'm kind of surprised when I read this story that Naaman actually got his healing. Aren't you? Because when you look at it, you find out that there was something about this guy that it wasn't surprising in this situation because of his disease, because of leprosy. But what was so surprising about this that he got his healing was because of his pride and because of his anger. You see, these are both displayed at first when he shows up to Elisha's house. And he's expecting Elisha to come out and make some big fanfare over him. Why? Because this is a big dog. He is captain of the host of the king of Syria. He is there to make a scene. I have arrived and I need a great healing. And so he expected Elisha himself. We read it in the chapter there. He expected Elisha to come out himself and proclaim over him healing, and then that God would totally deliver him from his leprosy. His anger turns to rage after that when the Bible tells us that he is asked by the servant. Now, he's not asked by Elijah, but it's come through second hand of this little puny servant that wasn't really good enough of a servant. He wanted the messenger to be the very man of God himself. But this is what is so unique, because here in this story, he was simply asked to go wash in the Jordan River, and then he was going to be able to be delivered. And the Bible says that his anger turned to rage, not because he was asked to dip 7 times, not because something was so very mightily difficult, but because to him, the waters weren't good enough. Now, he didn't say anything about the 7 times, but there's something about me that kind of imagines that he, every time that he went down, was begrudging the whole concept. You know, sometimes even kids obey with a not very obedient spirit. You don't have kids, you have no idea what I'm talking about. But if you got kids, you know exactly what I'm talking about. He was upset about everything else already. But fortunately, his servants had some wisdom, and they said, "Naaman, we have to ask you an honest question. Did he really honestly ask you to do something hard? Did he ask you to do something that you absolutely could not do?"
Right.
Now, this is something that you and I could really ask about concerning our salvation. Because when it came to you and I being saved, did he really ask us to do something impossible? Did he really ask us to do something that we absolutely could not do? I don't know about you, but the fact that he came in his word and he just simply said, "All I want you to do is repent of your sins. And I want you to be baptized in my name. I want you to receive my spirit. I want you to live a life that's worthy of my name." That is something that each and every one of us can do if we will allow his spirit to move through our lives. God did not ask us to do something that we're not capable of doing. Not only is it not impossible, but it actually creates one of the most blessed lives of people in all of the world. People that are saved and that have His Spirit and have been blood washed. They have some of the most joyful lives of any people in all the earth. I don't know if there's anybody here for just a moment that would be willing to say that, yes, sometimes things are difficult, but because I've got the Lord in my life, this is still the best decision that I've ever made. I'm so glad that I lived for the Lord. He didn't ask me to do something like you. He didn't ask me to talk for somebody else like you. He didn't just ask me to go to things for me. I've been going back to school a little bit here recently. When I was in Indiana Bible College 100 years ago, back in the day of Moses or Noah, something like that, they didn't offer Greek. It was right in the middle of time between the time we had Greek teachers and So Andy's going to school, Jenny's going to school, Jared's going to school, Lizzie's going to school, Courtney's going to school, everybody's going to school, so I thought, I may as well go to school. And you know, I learned something. You get in the middle of all of these teenagers and you learn that sometimes they talk a little bit differently. Well, there was one of the kids that said, hey, I'm in the slob, but I'm getting ready to meet you in the blob. And I'm new here. I didn't think that a slob was something you could be in. I thought it was something that you were. You're in the slob, and you're heading up to the blob. Oh, well, a lot of change since I've been there. Oh, okay, then I found out these are terminologies. The slob is the student lobby. And the blob is the business lobby. Thank God. Thank God it was simple. But I don't know if you've noticed this over the years, but teenagers love to use the word like.
Yeah.
You ever noticed this? They love to use the word like. And I just imagine if the servants of Naaman were teenagers, then I can just kind of imagine them saying, well, like, Naaman, it's not like you like asked to like something really like hard to do. Naaman, the only thing like that he really like asked you to do like was to go like lost in the like water. And just like kick yourself 7 times. Now I just kind of imagine that we take a look at these concepts and we recognize this, and I don't know exactly how it was presented, but I want you to understand this. He did not ask David to do something that was impossible. And God, your Lord, has not asked you to do anything impossible. It may be difficult, but it was supposed to be with you. He was supposed to be with you. See, and this is something that's powerful in this story. I love the fact that he at least didn't display anger over how many times that he had to dip. But I want you to recognize something, that Naaman had something that was an advantage over you. And that advantage was that something that Naaman got right was he did not quit when he was asked to dip 7 times. That's one thing that he got right. But I got a question for you. How easy is this for Naaman knowing exactly how many times that he's got to dip? It's a lot easier. He gets to 5. There's only 2 more left. He gets to 6. Bless God. After this, it's just 1 more dip in this muddy old river, and I'm done. And he goes down for the 7th time, and he comes up, and he's healed. How easy is that he knew exactly how many times that he had to go down and come up? You see, my question is simply this. How many times do you have to pray before your answer comes? I don't know. How many times do you have to fight temptation before that temptation is finally won victory over? I don't know. How many times do you got to come down and pray at the altar for God to heal you or to turn your situation around until he does it? I don't know. The only thing that I know is that Naaman had to understand this concept. When it comes to number 6, he recognized this one thing. I got to go 1 more time. This is what you got to have, the spirit in your life. I don't know how many times I got to pray. He hasn't answered this prayer yet, so I'm going to pray 1 more time. I'm still struggling with this thing in my life, and I don't know when he's going to answer it. God, all I do is keep praying 1 more time. You keep fighting 1 more time. You keep going to the center. You keep fighting. You keep fighting. Because I understand this. I may not know how many times that you've got to fight what you're going through, but I know this. You will never taste victory if you quit too soon. If you're just 5 minutes away from your victory and you stop, you will never know what the thrill of it is of life to be on the top with God. I came to tell somebody here today, you cannot afford to quit in this race. You don't have time to turn around. That's why you gotta pray 1 more time. That's why you gotta resist temptation 1 more time. That's why you gotta come to the altar 1 more time. And I remember Brother Scott came down to the altar for a long time when he was seeking for the Holy Ghost. Brother Scott was coming to the altar. And man, I don't understand why I ain't getting the Holy Ghost. Well, I don't know, Brother Scott, but this is just the one advice that I got for you. Go down one more time. Go down one more time. And there was a day when God filled Brother Scott with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I don't know how many times you're going to have to come to get the answer that you want from God, but the one thing you cannot do, stop. You can't quit. Because you never know when you're just 5 minutes from time. I heard of a man I never met personally. I heard of a powerful story of a man that really needed something from God. He needed an answer so bad. He decided to go on a 3-day fast. So he went on a 3-day fast. He told his family, I just got to go lock myself into a hotel room for 3 days and I just got to talk to the Lord because I need something so bad from God. There he was praying and he was fasting. I don't know if you've ever done a 3-day fast, but if you're hooked on caffeine, it'll just plumb throw you into fits. Your head will hurt. Your body will resist. Your body will rebel. Everything about it was just going to feel like, man, there's one thing I need to do. I need to stop this fast. And I need to get me some coffee because I'm going to explode. But there was something about this man. It was the third day and his head hurt and his mind was swirling and his body was rebelling. And he knew inside, man, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. I can't continue. He was going to stop the fast. I know he'd say, God would understand. Yes, God would understand, sir, but your need still hasn't been met. And your prayer has still not received an answer. And so he thought, well, I just don't think I can go any longer. And just when he convinced himself to stop the fast, the Lord began to speak into his heart. And he said this, just go a little bit longer. Just go a little bit longer. Don't stop right now. In other words, you're just 5 minutes from the top. You're just a few moments away from when I'm going to step in and I'm going to answer the prayer that you've been praying. You've been fasting and you've been reaching out to me for these 3 days and you don't think that I'm seeing what's going on, but I see every bit of your praying and every bit of your fasting. Just a little bit longer. And he said, all right, Lord, I'll hold on. These are the things, the amazing things of God that sometimes people don't believe, but I believe in them 100%. You see, because in that moment, just a few moments later, an angel of the Lord walked into the room where he was. He said, now, I know there's a tendency to be afraid, but he looked at the man and said, listen, don't be afraid. It's going to be all right. I've come here to bring an answer to your prayer. And he reached his hand inside of that man's body. And he pulled out something black and ugly and that he knew was causing this man all kind of turmoil in his body, and he discarded that. And with the other hand, he had something that was bright and shiny and it was glowing, and he took that and he stuck it inside the body of that man, and he looked at him and he said, from this day forward, everything is going to change. From this day forward, you're going to have a different anointing. From this day forward, you're going to have a different level of blessing. That old junk I've taken out, and I've put something new inside of your life. I want you to know, first of all, God, how are you still able to do that kind of stuff in the lives of people that are hungry and thirsty for you to do something for them? But here is the question. What in the world would have happened if you would have said, listen, I felt that from God, but I decided that I was not going to continue to fast. I was going to stop. He never would have known the glory of God. He never would have had that heavenly visitation if somehow he would have made up his mind, I'm going to stop this fast and I'm not going to do this anymore. You see, folks, we don't know what we really could have in God when we quit. We don't understand what really could happen in our lives when we stop doing what God has asked us to do, when we're pushing and we're striving and we're thirsting and we're hungry for God. Something gets a hold of us and causes us to slow down. You gotta understand, you will never find that glory. You will never find that answer if you stop doing what God wants you to do. You can't quit. How many times have you been tempted? But instead of continuing on, you quit. And you just gave in because it was easier. What did the Lord really want to do in your life? How many times have you started growing in God? You picked that prayer life up, you were studying, you come to church and you're worshiping. But then the enemy comes and he starts to challenge you and he starts to make messes in your life, and so you go backwards and you quit. It's just too hard. You ever thought about where you could be today if you wouldn't have quit over the times of your life? I do. I'm human. I think about the times I'm human. I think about the times where I was in a place I loved and something happened and the enemy, I allowed him to throw me off track. Folks, we're all human. I want you to understand this. We're all in this whole thing of life together. And every one of us can look at things in our lives and we look back and we wish that we would have made a different decision and we wish we would have quit. That's exactly what I want to talk to you about today. Listen, folks, how many times has God tried to help you to get victory over that one area? Now, you know yourself. People, you know yourself. There might be that one area of your life that just seems to mess your life up and it plagues you. And it always seems to be that one thing that throws you off track of living for God. And you look at it and it just burns you to no end. Why? Because you look back and you know that what bothers you the most is it's always that one particular thing that causes you to quit. It causes you to quit. Maybe you're here today and you thought, man, that one thing is never going to change. There's no hope in that. I could never overcome that. I could never see a change in that. But God said in His Word that all things are possible. You hear that with God? All things are possible. But that possibility cannot come to fruition if you're running the wrong direction from where the Lord really wants you to go. As I prayed about this message over the past several weeks, and especially earlier on in this week, there were just two words that just kept coming to my mind and that just kept coming to my spirit, and two simple words called unfinished business. Unfinished business. You see, some of you are here today and you've got unfinished business in your life. You quit too soon and you gave up at the wrong time. And you don't have the victory that you want and your prayer hasn't yet been answered. You aren't where you thought that you would be at this point in your life. And you look back and what you see is there something in your past that says, man, if I would have just done something different, I would be different today. God, I've got some unfinished business in my life. There's a lot of us here today that are familiar with the story of Judas Iscariot. It was Judas that betrayed Jesus to the religious leaders, and the Bible tells us that he was paid 30 pieces of silver for the betrayal of Jesus Christ the Lord. But in Matthew 27, it tells us that Judas tried to undo his error. He tried to reverse what he did. But you know, the fact of the matter is you can't unbetray somebody. You can't unbetray them. You can't unmake a bad decision that you made years ago. You can't unwalk a path that was the wrong path 10 years ago. You can't change it. But you see, there was something about this when Judas realized that he could not change that poor decision. It was the worst of all decisions, even though we know it played right into the will of God. Jesus had to die. But Judas could have said, let it be by somebody else and not me. But when he realized that that situation was something that he could not change, he decided to throw his whole entire life away. You study it out, and the Bible said that he went and hanged himself. Yeah. Folks, I want you to understand something. Judas may have been too late to change his decision, but he didn't have to throw his whole entire life away because of that decision. That is something that plagues people in this day and age. They'll say, I made that decision back there. And at that very moment that they made that life-changing decision that was wrong, their vision for their life stopped. And their usefulness in their own mind ceased to exist. And they've been crippled by fear and doubt and that plaguing of their mind that they'll never be able to do anything for God again. And they'll never find meaning for their soul ever again. But I came to let somebody know here today, it's just because you made a decision in the past that was not right, there is still hope for today. And there is still All Jews needed to do was go to a different country. Go to a faraway place. Maybe a land with a bunch of Thaddeuses. And change his name to Thaddeus. I'm just one of the Thaddeuses of all the 100,000 Thaddeuses in this city. Nobody ever would have known. One the day of media like we live in, nobody would ever have known. He could have still had his life intact. He could have still found some way to find forgiveness to the Lord, even though his decision was one of the worst in history. We could have been reading something different about Judas. Yes, he betrayed the Lord, but the Lord forgave him. Didn't we read that about Peter? Peter denied the Lord, but yet the Lord forgave him. And we preach about how he had the keys, and he preached the first message to the Jews and to the Gentiles of salvation. Folks, I want you to know something today. Your past decisions and your past bad directions and your past bad paths do not have to dictate the direction of vision that you can have for your life today. God is still able to turn you around. He's still able to speak into your soul. He's still able to use for the glory of his kingdom. One of the guys that I admire the most, I shock you. I respect a man more than I can tell you. I'm going to tell you why, and then I know I'm going to have to clarify this. One of the men that I respect the most is a man that used to be a United Pentecostal Church preacher. But he lost his license because he was unfaithful to his wife. Now, there are a lot of guys, I got to clarify this, I know. You see, there are a lot of people that when something like that happens, then all of a sudden their whole life is destroyed and they go off into oblivion and they go away from God and you never hear from them again. But this particular gentleman not only found reconciliation with his wife, which I thank God for, but there was something that was so precious about him where he made up his mind, I'm not going to let what I did, it was just a freak one thing mistake that never should have happened, and I can't go into all the story. He knew what he did was wrong and he shouldn't have done it, but this is the thing. What he decided to do after this happened was he meets now with young ministers and young ministers' wives, and he says, let me tell you about my story. Let me tell you the mistake that I made. Why? Because I don't want you guys to ever go through this mistake. I don't want you to ever have to deal with what I dealt with. I don't want you to have to be able to stand in front of a board and say you can't have a license with the United Pentecostal Church because you did this. And I sat there at a table as this man told the whole story. He told every single detail of how he fell and why he fell and the torment that he was going through that caused the weak moment. And he was there at a time when most of the people would run away and they would quit and they would hide. But he said, no, what I'm going to do, I'm going to do everything I can to not only get my life right, but I'm going to help other people to not have to go through that very same thing. I don't know about you, but I have a lot of respect for that. What he is saying, what I'm saying is, you can still have a place of victory in your life. This guy today is living in victory. He has one of the most precious spirits of a man you will ever meet in your life. God is using him to help other people. He turned his whole life around because he said, I am not going to let this make me quit. I'm not going to let one bad decision dictate the rest of my life. But I'm going to let something bad and use the God so that I can help somebody else find salvation. You see, what you got to do today, folks, if there's some unfinished business that you have in your life, you got to start making some declarations. You got to say something like this. This right now, right here, is not how I want to go out. This is not the way that I want to be remembered. I don't want to be remembered as the God that quit 5 minutes from the top, but I want to be remembered as the God that even though my story catch me, I don't want to be remembered. I want to be one of them that made it to the top. I want to be one of them that are victorious. I want to be one that conquers my fears. I want to be one that overcomes temptation. These are declarations that you got to start making in your life right here, right now, today. You got to finish business, then you get up and say, I want to get my spiritual life back together. I want to have that relationship with the Lord that I used to have. I've laid it down somewhere and I can't find it. I've let bad decisions totally torment me for years. It's unfinished business, but I'm picking something back up today. A declaration that this is not how I'm going to stay. I'm not going to turn around when I'm just 5 minutes from the top. Unfinished business. You don't have to make these declarations today. You don't have to get out of your seat and run around the church shouting to everybody the declarations that you're going to make. Well, sometimes evangelists, when they come, they just get concerned because they want you to, they want your whole life to change. One message. Pastors are different. Your life is not always going to change in one message. But the more that you hear the Word of God, the more you listen, and the more you're around the Spirit, the more you're around good people, the more your life is going to change. And so what I'm hoping is that somehow this week you're going to start thinking about this message. You're going to realize, wow, God, I look back 10 years ago and I made a decision there that was hard to me. And from that point on, it seems like the spiritual life is just died right there. What I want you to be able to do in your life somehow is to say, God, I've got some unfinished business. I'm going back to that place and I'm picking up where I left off. And I'm going to pick up a vision for my life again. I'm going to pick up some passion for God. I might have quit a little while ago, but I made up my mind that I'm not in the quit business. Jesus has never quit on you. This church will never quit on you. I'm going to quit on you. Somebody else may have quit on you, but I ain't never quit on you. What kind of unfinished business is going on in your life today? What have you laid down that you want to get back? I want you to understand this. Nobody can give it to you. There's not a magic spell or a magic wand that just automatically gives you your stuff back for your relationship. It takes you and it takes God coming to grips with this one thing. Lord, I'm not going to give up. I'm coming back to you. I'm coming back to my relationship. I'm coming back to my faith, Lord. I'm coming back with a fresh determination. But I'm not going to be the person that quits 5 minutes at the time. Just stand with me right now, please. Lord has been here all service long. Just such a beautiful spirit, God. From the beginning of the service, there's a beautiful spirit of the Lord here today. And I'm praying for somebody that would just make a determination in their mind. You may not have all the understanding of really what you need to do about this today. But you're just willing to say, God, the kind of person that I want to be is the kind of person that doesn't quit before you do in my life what I know that you want to do. Some of you still have ministries that are unfulfilled. Please listen to me. Some of you have ministries that are still unfulfilled because something happened and you laid it down years ago. Some of you have callings of intercession. Some of you have things that God has promised and they still haven't come to pass. Some of you have loved ones that still aren't in the house of God. Have you prayed? Some of you have situations that you still don't have an answer for. But I want you to come to the altar today and say, Lord, I'm not turning around. I'm not turning back. I'm not giving up. I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to keep persevering. There's still time in my life to do something for you. Lord, there's time in my life for there to be some powerful things. You can get your victory back, folks. You can get your life back on track. You can get a prayer answer. Remember, it's one more time. It's one more time. When you stop, everything cease, but you got to keep trying again. You got to keep trying again. Rejoice not against me, O my enemy, but I fall. I'm going to get back.